Okay, awesome. So let's look at the scope of the problem. We think about 40% of girls and 20% of boys will have syncope prior to the age of 18. The incidence increases with age and peaks in adolescence, as you're aware if you work in the emergency community. The etiology tends to be vasovagal and orthostatic. That's our number one cause. 9% present with some sort of neurologic etiology, and about 2% are cardiac, and less than 1% of those are a new cardiac diagnosis. So here's our exclusions today. I am not going to talk about syncope due to congenital heart disease because that's a whole nother topic, both unrepaired and repaired. And we're not going to specifically talk about syncope in patients with devices. So those who have known pacemakers, defibrillators, or anti-tachycardia devices. An implantable loop recorder is something that we use to diagnose patients who have infrequent syncope or arrhythmias that we can't diagnose with other forms of recording devices. And those we do use when we're talking about syncope in this population. All right, so the common syncope, we look at it in groups of, basically when I think of it as cardiac versus non-cardiac. So vasovagal or neurally mediated syncope is a common form of syncope. It tends to be triggered by a warm environment. This is the kind where you get syncope from a blood draw or a painful situation. Happens sometimes in science classes if they're seeing graphic detailed images. Or other things, yeah. Some of the movies that are out have some pretty graphic details in it. And then position. This can happen when they're sitting or upright, but often happens more so when they're upright. Or if they start to feel funny and they get up, the kids often will describe being in a science class, or they are doing a dissection or something like that, and then they'll stand up to go to the bathroom because they feel nauseous, and then they faint upon standing. And then there are some situational forms of this type of syncope, and they're kind of unusual. We have had hair pulling syncope where the girls are curling their hair or somebody is blow drying their hair, and then they start to be presyncopal and faint if they stand up. Micturition or defecation syncope is another form, usually with boys. Cough or sneeze syncope, and then if you have a deep valsalva, you can also have an episode of syncope. And then the orthostatic hypotension tends to happen in people who have autonomic dysfunction or those who have hypovolemia. So this will be a kid who maybe had a history of a diarrheal infection or acute gastroenteritis, and they're a little bit dehydrated, and then when they stand up, they feel dizzy, and then they can faint. And then there's a whole other group called postural orthostatic tachycardia syndrome, or POTS. And this is a group that we're kind of identifying more of now. They often don't have frank syncope, but they'll have presyncope, dizziness. And I have a slide on that because I know that that's a common discussion among people who take care of these kids. So the diagnosis is typically made as an outpatient, so we hope that they're not coming into the emergency room a lot, and we hope that if they are seen in the emergency room, they make their way to our outpatient clinic. And we actually do have a POTS clinic at UW that takes place on a Monday. It's run by one of our nurse practitioners who's excellent, has been doing this for several years, and has made great strides with this patient population. So the diagnosis is frequently made in the clinic. We usually don't make this diagnosis in the emergency room because when they come into the emergency room, they often are pretty ill, they're not feeling well, and so their heart rate response is going to be a little bit different than if we catch them under more normal circumstances. But in the office, we have them lying supine first, and we get a heart rate and blood pressure, and then we have them stand up. And the diagnosis in adults is made by a heart rate that's 120 beats per minute or greater, or there's an increase of 30 beats per minute or greater from the resting supine heart rate to that standing heart rate, and that has to be persistent for several minutes. So what they'll do is they'll have them lie down, and then they'll have them stand up for at least 10 minutes, and they'll be following their heart rate during that time. Now, I have 30 to 40 written here because in the pediatric population, it's a little bit different because their heart rates are going to be faster in younger kids anyway, naturally. And so the 120 really isn't that helpful, but we use an increase of 30 to 40 beats per minute, and that can be extremely variable. So some kids will have an increase like that, and they don't all have postural orthostatic tachycardia syndrome. So we have to kind of keep it in mind with their presenting symptoms. These kids, and it's often adolescent females, They will feel a fast heart rate. They'll often have some dizziness or lightheadedness, but frank syncope is rare. And then they have this constellation of associated symptoms like chronic fatigue. They can have constipation, abdominal pain. The management in the emergency room, again, we hope that they don't arrive in the emergency room, but they often will respond to IV fluids to get them kind of stable from a clinical standpoint, and then they can go out and follow up in clinic. In the clinic, for these patients, we talk about increasing their fluid intake, eating salty snacks. We try to put them on an exercise program that allows them to have regular isometric activity, particularly of their lower extremities. And then we sometimes use compression stockings, and there are medications to use as well. If you're going to get labs on these kids, we like to check for anemia, of course, but a ferritin level is helpful as well, because some of them won't have frank anemia, but will have a low ferritin, and then they'll respond to iron supplements. So that's just a word about POTS. I put in this video just to show kind of a common type of syncope. Again, this isn't POTS. This would be a child who has vasovagal syncope. So this is a school play, I think, during the holiday period. And I got this off the internet. So that's what Fainting Productions is. So I want you to watch this child here. And you can start to see he feels a little bit uncomfortable and then is kind of moving back and forth. And then with vasovagal syncope, typically they'll just become very limp and they'll fall. And if they don't recognize that they're having the episode, they can hit pretty hard. So when we think of cardiac versus vasovagal syncope or the common syncope, one of the things we think about is, did they injure themselves? Because we think about cardiac syncope, it happens suddenly, they fall down and they potentially have some ramifications from that with a head laceration or facial laceration. This can still happen. You can still have pretty impressive syncope from vasovagal syncope. So I'll play this. It's relatively short, just a couple seconds. And you could see he falls. And you know, he falls really suddenly. There were other videos that were even more traumatic than this that I didn't want to show. Okay, so this one I put in, this is an adult who has an episode of vasovagal syncope. And what I want to do, and I'll roll back on this film after we play it, but you can see that there is some movement that almost looks like seizure activity. And I'm bringing this out because a lot of parents or caretakers who bring the child in, there's a report that there was a seizure or seizure-like activity. And with this form of syncope, you can get myoclonus, and it's the shaking. It's not extremely rhythmic, but a little bit of shaking, and it'll be transient. And sometimes people will perceive that as actually a seizure. And so they'll be brought in with this history of seizure. So, oops, let me see if I can get this to play. Okay. And there's some audio with it, but they're just interviewing this person who just actually got finished skydiving. And then I want you to watch his leg right there. See the little tremor he has? That's this myoclonic activity. And what's interesting, I'll play it one more time so y'all can see it again, because this is quite common. And if you do tilt table tests on adolescents or adults, you often see this either as they're passing out or immediately afterwards. And you could see the shaking, see the little shaking of the leg. So he's actually, he's syncopized, but this is his little myoclonic tremor. And it's really interesting because if you're looking at recording devices, like we'll have a 30-day event monitor, and oftentimes on the recording device, we'll see this this myoclonic activity show up, and people will get it confused with actually a tachycardia or a heart rate because it's artifact on the rhythm strip. All right, so we're going to move into some of the lesser common types of syncope, which is sudden cardiac death or potential for that in children and adolescents. It's rare, 1 to 2 per 200,000. It's estimated about that. Obviously, these are in the news, so they seem like they're more frequent because they often will happen with young athletes who are in the middle of athletic event. There's a family history sometimes of seizures, syncope, or early sudden death. We also ask about SIDS because about 10% of SIDS will present with some type of inherited arrhythmia. We ask about ICDs and pacemakers, particularly at a young age. We ask about drownings in people who otherwise know how to swim, and single car accidents because we're thinking that the patient had an event and then drove off the road. It wasn't like they were hit. So when we look at evaluation of these patients, we really know that the physical exam has to be done. You have to have a very good history. It's important to get a family history because some of the inherited arrhythmias that we see in other types of cardiomyopathies are inherited in an autosomal dominant fashion. And then the 12-lead ECG, although among the normal, otherwise normal pediatric population, has a fairly low specificity, we know that in combination with a physical exam history and family history, a 12-lead ECG should be done in patients who have syncope. So the first thing I'm going to mention is hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. This happens in about 1 out of 500. It's usually inherited in an autosomal dominant fashion, and the ECG will show increased QRS voltages and abnormal repolarization. They have ventricular tachycardia that causes their syncope, and that's either due to a primary arrhythmia due to abnormal myocytes or myocardial scarring, or it can be due to ischemia. So I put this as kind of a busy slide, but I put it in just to show you two ECGs that were done actually on, one was an athlete, one was a football player, a collegiate football player actually, and the other was a 13-year-old who presented with not exertional syncope, but syncope after dinner, which you would think of maybe it's more basovagal. The top one was a football player. Again, he did not have syncope with exercise, but was heard to have a heart murmur on examination following a football practice. So here is just a schematic showing what our echoes look like and how we measure the wall thicknesses. This is the right ventricle here, the left ventricle. This is the interventricular septum and the left ventricular free wall. So when we're looking at the left ventricle for dilation, this is our echo image. Below, I put an actual echo picture showing how that looks. So this is the LV free wall and the septum. This ECG was on the football player who presented after a practice with just a murmur, had had no symptoms at all. And what I want to point out to you are two things that are very common with significant hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. One is the lateral precordial leads, V5 and V6, have increased R waves. So this is indicative of left ventricular size, particularly hypertrophy, to see these big R waves here in V6. They should normally only be 20 to 25 millivolts, and we're up here past 30. And then the other thing to look at that's really important is the repolarization. So your T wave should be upright in the lateral precordial leads, and he's flipped here. So adults recognize this right away as some type of what we often call it LVH with strain, but this is very abnormal. They should always be upright starting at a week of age all the way throughout life, unless you have a cardiac issue. The other thing is that there's a difference in the T wave. These are now, so that's the precordial leads. In the limb leads, there's a difference in axis between the QRS axis and the T wave. And the easy way that I try to remember it is that if you have a mostly upright R wave, you should always have an upright T wave. And so this is an inverted T wave. So this is upright and inverted. If you look at this, this is inverted and upright. So there's greater than a 90 degree difference in axis between the QRS and the T wave. So you can do this by pattern recognition pretty quickly to say, hey, this is inverted here and it should be upright because my QRS is upright. So this patient's EKG was clearly abnormal. And when we got the echo, this was his echo. And you can see this is his interventricular septum here. It's huge. These are centimeter markers here. So it's 3 centimeters here and about a centimeter there. So the kids like this with left ventricular hypertrophy, what happens is they have poor ventricular filling. If they get a little dehydrated, they end up having left ventricular outflow tract obstruction. They don't have good flow out their aorta. And then their coronaries, there's a supply-demand mismatch, right? Because you have this thick myocardium and the coronary filling is going to be horrible. Our coronaries fill in diastole and there's just not enough time to do that. And so oftentimes these patients will present during an athletic event and have a ventricular tachycardia or ventricular fibrillation and need resuscitation. This patient has what we used to call IHSS, idiopathic hypertrophic subaortic stenosis, where their stenosis is just in the septum itself. And you can see almost the same look here, but it's just isolated to the septum. They're gonna have big voltages in the right precordial leads or the mid precordial leads because that's where the septum's located, and a real paucity of R waves on the left side where this this was left ventricular hypertrophy. Now we have septal hypertrophy here, but we see the same pattern of this abnormal QRS to T wave axis in the limb leads. Okay, so those are kind of pearls to think about when you're looking at hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. It's interesting because oftentimes we'll see actually some changes in repolarization even before we see changes in the voltages because of the abnormal myocardium without significant thickening. Okay, so now we'll move on to long QT syndrome. This is a common one. People hear about this all the time. Its incidence is about 1 in 2,500 to 1 in 5,000, and it's primarily inherited in an autosomal dominant fashion. There is one form called Jervell-Lange-Nielsen that's autosomal recessive, but most of them are autosomal dominant, and they're considered to be in this group of ion channelopathies, typically sodium or potassium channel ionopathies. And then there are almost always we see a prolonged repolarization. So I just put these markers here to show you. This is a younger child. The heart rate is about 140 beats per minute, but this is just showing that what we do is we use Bizet's formula. Oftentimes the EKG, the computer generated analysis will show you the QTC, but it's important to check and make sure that that's accurate because that's one of our highest false positives is the repolarization. We take the beginning of the Q wave to the end of the T wave. We put that into Bizet's formula, which is the QT divided by the square root of the preceding R to R. And that's why I have marked the preceding. Obviously, if someone's in bigeminy or they don't have a real irregular rhythm, you can't measure using Bizet's formula. So these patients, the thing we're concerned about with them is that they can have an episode called torsade de pointe, which is type of polymorphic ventricular tachycardia. It's a French term that means twisting around the peaks, and you can see where this almost looks like it's kind of twisting. It gets a little bit bigger and then a little bit smaller and a little bit bigger. This is a non-perfusing rhythm, obviously. This was the preceding rhythm. This was a patient with known long QT, was on beta blockers, but then had this breakthrough episode while she was walking. When we think about long QT, everybody thinks about it as happening with exertion or stress, which is true for the majority. The most common types of long QT syndrome are LQT 1 and 2. These are potassium ion channel defects, and they do happen with exertion or stress or startle, but there is a form of LQT, the third most common, LQT 3, that happens with rest and sleep. There are a lot of different, I think we have 19 different types of long QT, but the majority are this LQT 1 through 3. You can also get long QT syndrome, which is acquired, and that's through medications, electrolyte disturbances, sometimes CNS tumors or trauma can cause that. And there are a list of medications that we like to avoid in our patients with congenital long QT syndrome or those to avoid who may have acquired. And those are, people know about those typically. Probably the most common we have is Z-Pak or azithromycin. The macrolide antibiotics can cause prolongation. So if you have a patient with long QT, you want to avoid it. But there are medications, particularly an overdose. Some of the psychotropic medications can cause long QT syndrome. Okay, now we'll move on to Wolff-Parkinson-White syndrome or WPW. The incidence of a delta wave on an ECG is about 1.5 in 1,000. Not all of those patients will have SVT or problems with their WPW. When I put this in here, I put it in here not to talk about SVT, which is the most common type of arrhythmia that you can get with WPW, but to talk about this potential for a life-threatening arrhythmia. So I just have a couple slides on WPW I wanted to show you. This first one is showing what the conduction system looks like. This is normal conduction. So normally start out in the sinus node, go through the AV node. And then if you have WPW, you can have pre-excitation through this pathway, and that will result in this portion of the ventricle being depolarized early. And on an ECG, that is associated with this delta wave. So we have normal atrial depolarization. And then instead of having this nice isoelectric portion of the ECG, the time that it takes to get through the AV node, we have the delta wave, which is this depolarization or pre-excitation of the ventricle. So patients with WPW can have SVT, and that SVT is relatively rapid. It will usually be a very nicely perfused rhythm. It's amazing because their heart rates can be 220, 250, even babies can have 280, and they'll do pretty well in that for some period of time. But that arrhythmia typically will occur by going down the AV node and then up the accessory pathway. And I describe it to parents like a dog chasing its tail. It goes around and around until something gets in and stops it. So in this patient, they got adenosine, which blocks in the AV node. And we see a brief pause. And then this first beat that comes in is actually sinus with a delta wave. And then the next beat, you don't see the delta wave anymore because the conduction through the AV node and sinus is better than the conduction through the AV node and pathway together. So I like to run a rhythm strip when we have patients with SVT and we're giving adenosine or we're doing some type of Valsalva maneuver to terminate their tachycardia, because you can actually see then potentially the reason for the SVT. Because this child, when we got the regular ECG, there was no pre-excitation because it was only transient after block in the AV node. So these patients can have, instead of having this more common type of SVT, which usually allows for a nice perfusing rhythm, you can have rapid antegrade conduction down the accessory pathway only. So this is the cause of sudden death in less than 1% of all patients with WPW. So it's relatively infrequent, but it's known to happen. And so here's what happens with these patients. They can develop spontaneous atrial fib flutter. And that atrial fib flutter in an otherwise healthy person would block at the AV node. The AV node has what's called decremental conduction. So the faster that comes down, the more the AV node's not going to allow that to come down to the ventricles. And so if you have atrial flutter, you might be blocked 2 to 1. So the flutter rate is 400. Maybe your ventricular rate will be 200 beats per minute. But in a patient with WPW, if they have rapid antegrade conduction down their accessory pathway, atrial fib flutter can become ventricular fibrillation. So this is one of the things, if you have somebody with WPW and they have syncope, you want to be thinking, could their syncope be due to rapidly conducting atrial fib flutter? All right. So that is WPW. Now we'll move on. I only have two other things to talk about here, and then we can get to questions. The next is also not a very frequent abnormality that we see, but something called Brugada syndrome. That's about 1.5 per thousand. It is also inherited primarily in an autosomal dominant fashion. It's considered an ion channelopathy, and its causes are varied. But one of the most common is the sodium ion channel, SCN5A, and actually these mutations also cause LQT3, not typically in the same patient, but SCN5A is a gene product that has a lot of different abnormalities potentially if you have a mutation in the right spot. So the EKG, here's the thing here with Brugada syndrome, you can have an EKG that can be totally normal, or you can have a Brugada pattern. And the Brugada pattern is typically ST segment elevation in the right precordial leads and a bundle branch block pattern, but really isolated to the right precordial leads. So we can see this here. And the reason I put this here is I'm showing a baseline, and there are provocative testing you can do with different medications like Agmaline and Flecainide, where you can give the medicine, you can give this medicine to the child or adult who has a possible Brugada or a family history of Brugada. And if you bring out this pattern, then they are diagnosed with Brugada syndrome. So the key is here though, that you can have a completely normal EKG and still have Brugada syndrome. Fever is one of the provocations for it. So if a child has a fever and presents with syncope, it's one of the things to think about. It's interesting because we all often have people who are having either syncope or seizure-like activity, and that's the question, was it really a seizure? Was it a form of syncope, or is it a primary cardiac issue? So one of the things we like to do is on any first-time syncope or first-time seizure, we do like to get an EKG just to make sure that things look good, and then take a very good history of what their symptoms were prior to the episode. So we'll go on. This is one of the diagnoses of, we follow quite a few patients with CPVT or catecholaminergic polymorphic ventricular tachycardia. This is a really interesting form of an inherited arrhythmia that is caused from abnormalities in calcium regulation in the sarcoplasmic reticulum. It happens in about 1 out of 10,000. It's primarily autosomal dominant and affects the ryanodine receptor and calsequestrin. That's about 60% of the people we can genotype and get a positive result on. Here's the problem is they have a normal EKG, completely normal baseline EKG. Some will have some mild bradycardia, but typically it's normal. And they also have a completely normal echo. So how do we tell they have this? Their episodes happen with exertion. And here's an example of that. This is exercise-induced ventricular arrhythmia. They'll have increase a number of PVCs. So it'll start out single PVCs, usually at heart rates of 100 or 110. And as they continue to exercise, they have more complex ventricular arrhythmias. And this is a patient who has CPVT, and you can see that they have polymorphic VT. And then this type of VT is called bidirectional VT, where you see the QRS upright and then inverted, upright and inverted. And that's very common with CPVT. And again, this portion is non-perfusing rhythm, but then they get back in and they have a few beats of sinus. So we often, part of our evaluation is to get a Holter monitor if the kids are not old enough to exercise, because that's how we tell when they're exerting themselves, what the rhythm looks like. We often will get exercise tests too, and something like that typically will show up during an exercise test. Okay, so my syncope pearls are, this is my last slide, the most common form of syncope, particularly that we see in the emergency room, are vasovagal and postural. The history and family history are very important. We want to get a screening EKG on first-time seizures in syncope patients. And the ECG patterns to know that we see most frequently that are helpful are hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, WPW, long QT syndrome, and Brugada. And CPVT patients often will have a normal ECG and echo, and we need to have some type of exercise induction and ECG to follow them in order to figure out whether or not they have that particular disorder.
Awesome.
So I welcome questions.
Thank you so much. We will stop our recording.